Good afternoon. My name is Carol Goldberg. I'm professor of law here at UCLA, where I direct our joint degree program in law and American Indian Studies. And I am also a very proud core member of the Critical Race Studies faculty here at UCLA School of Law. And now I get to add to my claims to fame, having been Addie Rolnick's thesis advisor. Very proud of her and her work in organizing this event. I'm going to be moderating this last plenary panel, although there is, of course, a closing roundtable after this. And as you can see from the description in your program, traditionally in the U.S. domestic context, rights-based claims by Black, Asian, and Latino communities have been framed as demands for civil rights and full inclusion, while conversely, indigenous community struggles have been cast as demands for self-determination against forced inclusion in dominant nation states. But these are not just different claims by the different groups. There are also corresponding different strategies put forward by the dominant system corresponding to these different claims. In the case of rights-based claims by Black, Asian, and Latino communities, the corresponding response from the dominant system would be one of exclusion or segregation. In the case of indigenous community struggles, the dominant society corresponding response has been one of forced assimilation or forced inclusion, at least according to this traditional understanding. But I would take it further. It's not just that these claims by different groups are characterized differently. There is also some built-in conflict in this way of characterizing them. Because if you think about it, sovereignty is one of the foundational bases for practices of exclusion and segregation by dominant societies. And as we've seen in some of the earlier presentations, claims of sovereignty by Native nations have been invoked in the course of exclusionary practices, for example, with respect to the freedmen. At the same time, if you think about indigenous peoples' movements and claims, the very notion of equality has been used by the dominant society as a way of rebuffing or suppressing those claims. Certainly, if you go to the history, for example, of termination of tribes in the 1950s, the dominant congressional and executive branch discourse was laden with the value of equality as a way of advancing Native societies. And termination was very much framed as a movement for equality. So there is some real potential conflict if you understand the two groups and their movements in this fashion and at the same time the response of the dominant society in that fashion. So one of the important things that this panel is going to be doing is asking whether this account of the two movements and forces they combat is an accurate one. How, for example, would it explain the Voting Rights Act litigation brought by Native people, I might add, with some significant success in the upper Midwest and Rocky Mountain states, litigation very much brought in the name of equality and inclusion? How also would you account for Black separatist and Black power movements? If the movement is understood entirely as one seeking inclusion. So one of the important things this panel is going to be doing is calling into question the accuracy of this traditional characterization, or I would say dichotomy, that's been drawn. And I think another important thing that this panel will do, and I certainly don't want to limit what they will do with my remarks, but one of the things they will be addressing is whether, in fact, these two sets of claims or movements must, in fact, be in conflict with one another. We've seen in some earlier programs the concept of settler colonialism invoked as a way of finding some common ground between these two sets of movements. I might observe that Justice Thurgood Marshall's participation in the opinions in Santa Clara Pueblo against Martinez and in Morton against Mancari, I think, was no accident. I don't think that he was viewing the advancement of Native rights as an endangerment to the civil rights claims that he obviously valued so highly. But are there necessary conflicts between these two sets of movements? And furthermore, are there alternate ways of understanding both sovereignty and race that might bring these movements closer together? We've heard of phrases like layered sovereignty that Letty Volpe offered earlier. There are certainly a very distinctive understanding of sovereignty or self-determination that is put forward in the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which includes both values of group rights and individual rights, as earlier panelists have discussed. Well, we have a very distinguished group of panelists to speak to these issues today, and I will introduce them briefly now in the order in which they will speak. You have far more detail in your program that outlines their awards, distinctions, publications. This is truly a celebrated group. So first we will hear from my UCLA colleague Hiroshi Motomura, a very widely published and influential scholar in the area of immigration law. Next, we will hear from Professor Gerald Torres, the Bryant Smith Professor at the University of Texas Law School. And I don't think we can limit the scope of the scholarship in which he has made distinct and important contributions. But let's just say that they span areas such as Indian law, race law, and so on. Speaking after him will be Carlos Soltero, who is head of the litigation practice group at McGinnis, Lockridge, and Kilgore in Austin, Texas, who also has published widely as a practitioner on areas relating to Latinos in the law and other subjects. After him will speak Bethany Berger, a dear colleague of mine in publication efforts and very distinguished scholar in the field of Indian law, professor at the University of Connecticut Law School. And finally, our, I believe, lone non-lawyer, very brave, is Robin Kelly, professor of American Studies and Ethnicity and History at our crosstown rival of USC. But we welcome him warmly today. I look forward to their presentations. They will be each speaking from 10 to 15 minutes, which probably means closer to 15. And I will be in the unhappy role of police for that. And then we'll have some time for discussion. Thank you.
There. Okay. That's not a very elegant entrance, but start my stopwatch here. So thank you, Carol, and thanks to all of you for being here and to Critical Race Studies for organizing this great event. It's really important, and it's wonderful to be here. So the title of this panel is Enforced Belonging and Exclusion, and so I thought I'd try to address that from the point of view of someone who writes about immigration and citizenship. And I'll start with something that I think is fairly uncontested, but I think it's an important starting point, and that is that you know, race and sovereignty are absolutely essential, both conceptually and historically, to immigration and citizenship. And it's also often said, and quite true, that race historically has given content to sovereignty. Race has given content to sovereignty in the context of immigration and citizenship. I want to start with that, but I want to make a somewhat different or distinct argument and claim, and use this as a way of thinking about how race and sovereignty emerge conceptually and historically in immigration and citizenship, and perhaps as distinct from how it may emerge in related fields. Okay, and that's a question I want to just throw out in anticipation of what I'm going to say. How is this different from how it may work out outside of immigration and citizenship? But what I want to explain is that I think that over time, race has given content to immigration and citizenship. It has been used, race and sovereignty, I should say, has given content to immigration and citizenship. And race has been used to include and then exclude using different kinds of sovereignty-based line drawing. That's a lot in that one sentence, so let me just repeat it. That race is included and excluded through different kinds of sovereignty-based line drawing. And I want to briefly run through these because I think it's a way of understanding both the historical pattern, it's a way of understanding where we are today, and it's a way of conceptually trying to figure out how race and sovereignty operate in immigration and citizenship in ways that may be different in other areas of thinking about issues of power, subordination, and empowerment. The three are, just to overview this, the three are, I think that race has included and excluded through a type of sovereignty-based line drawing that draws a line between people who are conceived of as future Americans and people who are not. In a book I wrote, I used the term Americans in waiting for this, but it's really the line between people who are conceived of as future Americans and people who are not. That's one way of thinking about sovereignty. Okay, a second line that I want to spend a couple of minutes talking about is there's a sovereignty-based line between people who are here legally and people who are not here legally. That, too, is a way of expressing sovereignty. And the third is that there's a sovereignty-based line between state slash local authority on the one hand and federal authority on the other. And I think these are both ways in which the role of race, I mean, race is very pervasive, it's very persistent in this area of immigration and citizenship, and somehow it always manages to be formative, but it's interestingly formative in these three different lines as historical patterns. And so let me explain them in turn. And I'll start really with just some exclusionary landmarks in immigration law. I mean, I think that they're fairly well known to a lot of people here, but of course, citizenship was racially restricted for much of American history. The first naturalization statute in 1790 was limited to free white persons. That was the language. That was expanded after the Civil War to African Americans, and only in 1952 was it expanded to the point where there was no explicit racial bar to naturalization. And of course, birthright citizenship, which is now coming under attack again, is a zone or an area of exclusionary expression in American history. Okay, but here's what I mean by the first line. I think the first line I mentioned is the line between people who are Americans in waiting, in other words, thought of as future members of our community, and people who are not. Americans in waiting and other non-citizens. And what's interesting about that is that we now think of the sovereignty line, one sovereignty line that matters is the line between citizens and non-citizens. The line between citizens and non-citizens is what a lot of immigration scholars kind of basically obsess about. But the fact of the matter is that was not the line that mattered in the 19th century. In the 19th century, a lot of the rights of citizenship, in other words, sovereignty-based rights, were given to people, not just to people who were citizens, but also people who were intending citizens. In other words, people who filed declarations of intent to become citizens. And if you were an intending citizen, you had virtually the same rights, or let me not overstate that. You had, in many respects, the rights of citizenship if you were an intending citizen, but you could become an intending citizen the day after you got here by filing an intent to become a citizen in the future. Now, what's the race part of this? Well, the race part of this, of course, is that you could only file an intent, declaration of intent to become a citizen if you were eligible to citizenship, if you were white. And then you know, and so this would include many people actually whose whiteness was deeply contested during this period, which is another interesting sidelight. But this was a way in which the line that race operated not in the way we think about sovereignty today between citizenship and non-citizenship, but rather through the use of this more subtle line and in a sense more pervasive line that was interestingly not explicitly race-based. Not explicitly race-based in the way, for example, that the Chinese Exclusion Act explicitly identified a group of people who would be excluded. But it was through this line drawing that looked like formal law, it was drifting toward colorblindness, but not quite there. The expression intending citizen was colorblind, but certainly the explicit rules regarding citizenship were not. Okay, so that's example one of race operating through a version of sovereignty. Okay. Here's example two, and this is the line between lawful immigrants and people who are here outside the law. Now, one of the exclusionary landmarks here that's worth mentioning, many of you know this, of course, is that immigration has been racially restricted for much of American history. And one thing I want to focus on right now is the 1924 legislation that tied the number of people who would be admitted to a particular from a particular country into the United States tied to the percentage of the ethnic population in the late 19th century. So this was clearly an attempt to maintain the ethnic mix of the United States as it existed around the end of the 19th century. Now, that system, the national origin system, gets abolished in 1965, the 1965 amendments. And this was part of a legislative impetus that included the Voting Rights Act of 65 and the Civil Rights Act of 1964. But the price of formal equality in who would be admitted, were some things that I think, under the guise of a colorblind sovereignty, ended up being highly discriminatory. And so this, is the construction of the line between the illegal and the legal as the type of sovereignty that gives expression to racial exclusion. So I'll give you two examples of that. I mean, one is that the price of a uniform, the price of a the end of these national restrictions based on the ethnic mix in the 19th century, the price of that was to impose a uniform per country limit of what is now about 25,000 per year coming in through family and employment-based immigration categories, so-called immigration preferences from any given country. So what you have is a uniform cap that says we're only going to allow family immigration, family and employment-based preferences from Mexico at the 25,000 level. Same limit applies to everyone, no matter what country they're from. And so this, of course, completely ignores, as applied to Mexico, a lot of things. I'll just mention two of them. One is the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, which resulted, of course, in Mexico losing half of its lands to the United States in 1848. And the other is the near absence of lawful immigration categories for people whose work is very much in demand in this country as far as the economy is concerned, but there's no actual line to stand in because there is no line for people who don't have a four-year college degree, and even for people who have a four-year college degree, it's quite limited until you get to the master's degree level. And so what you have is a creation of a huge population of individuals who've come to this country and live here outside the law. Sovereignty expresses itself through the legal-illegal line, the invocation of the rule of law. That's the sovereignty version two that I'm outlining here. But clearly in admissions, there's a great deal of exclusionary work that's done by the admission system, and there's a great deal of exclusionary work that's done by an enforcement system that says we've got 11 million people in this country who are here outside the law, but we'll have a great deal of discretion as to whom the enforcement will operate against, and that could be in the context of workplace raids. It could also be in the context of selective enforcement of immigration as anti-terrorism law. So that's how race works through sovereignty in immigration law, sovereignty version two, the line between the legal and the illegal. So let me come to the third one here. The third version of sovereignty in immigration and citizenship, the third version in which race persists, is pervasive, and controls what actually happens. And this one's a little trickier because I think it cuts a lot of different ways. So far I've only discussed sovereignty in the sense of national sovereignty of the United States. But There is also a way to think about sovereignty more broadly as decision-making power, as enforcement, and there you'd have to think about a spectrum of sovereignties. Some are national, that's what I've been talking about so far, but there are also sovereignties that can be supranational or international or human rights-based. There can also be sovereignties that are more local, and so in other words, state and local sovereignties. So what's interesting about this is to think about the state and local versus federal line as another zone in which race operates through a version of sovereignty. So this is version 3. And the historical context is really important here because one thing that it's easy to forget now is that most immigration law was state and local in the 19th century, at least until 1875, for a lot of reasons, but I think the biggest reason, often overlooked today, but it's very obvious when you mention it, is slavery. When slavery existed, it was impossible to have federal regulation of migration or indeed of who we the people are. So what happens if you fast forward to the late 20th century is you have state and local activity in the area of immigration and citizenship starting. One landmark is the 1975 statute that keeps kids out of Texas public schools if they're in the country and undocumented, and that of course is a statute that gets struck down in Plyler versus Doe. But you also have Prop 187 in California, and then now you have a run of state and local laws to similar effect. A couple of observations there. One is that this again is a version of sovereignty in which race plays a role. And so when state and local legislators and actors decide that certain people don't belong, this is the reason that part of that feels like back to Dred Scott. That is, in some sense, the historical background in which this comes up. And so what happens is that it is the role of race coming through a version of sovereignty that is state and local and is exclusionary. But it's interesting also, and this is the complication, the last complication that I want to introduce here, and that is that state and local actors can also create inclusionary autonomous zones. This is what sanctuary cities are about, right? So you could also think of state and local versions of sovereignty as being exclusionary zones, back to Dred Scott. But you can also think of state and local zones of sovereignty as autonomous inclusionary zones. That's sanctuary cities, where you can have partial immunity from enforcement or other methods to integrate the undocumented into local communities. And so this is a way of understanding Arizona's SB 1070. I mean, in many respects, it's totally exclusionary in a state and local version of sovereignty. But the other way to think about it is it's also the state is trying to quash inclusionary local sovereignties, like the city of Phoenix and the city of Tucson. Okay. So just to wrap up here, I see I'm at 13 minutes and 22 seconds. So I'd like to, rather than saving my last 67 seconds for rebuttal, those of you who are my students know that I cannot think without drawing a picture or draw a picture without thinking. So I would like to show you a picture that tries to, with nothing else, summarize what I just said. Okay, and I invite you to object to the diagram but here's how it works. I've got this set up right. Okay, race and sovereignty and immigration. I'm just going to summarize what I'm going to say. One thing that happens in immigration law is separation and subordination, right? Another thing that can happen is include and empower. And the third thing, before I get to the third thing, let me just explain that explicit racial sovereignty. This is before I get to my version one. But you can have explicit race in sovereignty, and you can also have so-called colorblind sovereignty, where the racial dimension is much less obvious. Okay, so trans exclusion is an example of explicit racial sovereignty that separates and subordinates. Now, this business of ineligible for citizenship, if you were not white, you could not become a citizen, therefore you were not eligible. You were ineligible for citizenship, therefore you couldn't be an American in waiting. Therefore, you wouldn't have those rights. It's interestingly a hybrid between explicitly racial sovereignty, because explicitness was in the naturalization statute, but the ineligible to citizenship Americans in waiting language was seemingly colorblind. Then the national origins quota gets abolished in 1965. I mean, that is sort of colorblind sovereignty that includes some powers. But notice that per country limits is equally colorblind, and it's also quite subordinating and separating in the way that it treats Mexico, for example. I think of Arizona SB 1070 as something that's not, as explicit, that is on the surface colorblind, because it relies on the difference between legal and illegal, but in fact it really has a lot of separate and subordinate. Sanctuary cities is a way of thinking. One way to think about this is it's including and empowering, but in the local space, the local version of sovereignty. But you can also think of sanctuary cities as separating and empowering. In other words, to withdraw from the national exclusion and try to create local communities more inclusionary. So that's just a way of thinking about. That's the picture that was in my head when I was writing all that other stuff I tried to work out. So anyway, this is really, you know, in 14 minutes, race and sovereignty and how I think the way it works in immigration and citizenship. And the point really has been that it is very that race has been persistent in the history of immigration and citizenship. It is persistent today, but it has worked its way through, or had in effect through, different versions of what it means to be sovereign. Okay, thanks.
Well, what I'm going to try to do in 15 minutes is both complicated and simple. It's complicated because it's got the whole taxonomy that I'm about to suggest is contained within an understanding of the original colonial project of the British and its impact on the construction of the polity, combined with the project of slavery, and then a couple of wars in between, one which established the United States and one which reestablished the United States in the middle of the 19th century. Within that framework, I'm going to give you a taxonomy of citizenships. And so there's three kinds of citizenship that I'm going to suggest. First is state citizenship. The second is national citizenship. And the third is tribal. And here you can put a paren, you can put citizenship or membership. And I want to talk about why there's a parenthetical and why it might be conceived of differently. Now, when I said that these are contained within the broad question of the British colonial project, it's largely to juxtapose it to, say, the Spanish or the French colonial projects, which I'm not going to discuss, but I'd be happy to talk about afterwards. And the project was this, and that was to create a place for people who were coming from Britain, whether they were in refugee status or colonial status, however you wanted to categorize them, but essentially to create a polity that, one, expressly excluded native people, and two, expressly excluded people of African descent, so that you can turn to Dred Scott, for example, which kind of brings us far forward, but the court summarizes it, I think, clearly. The words people of the United States and citizen are synonymous terms and mean the same thing. They both describe the political body who form the sovereignty and who hold the power and conduct the government through their representatives. The question before us is whether the class of persons described in the plea, right, compose a portion of these people, right, that is, the people who can be citizens. Right? So it's kind of the category that Hiroshi described. And so initially, right, you had two classes of people who were defined initially as outside the polity, that is, the people who would not be part of the people. Now, after the revolution, of course, you have the question of successor state, right, an international law question. And so the question of successive state is then who has the power to define who's in and who's out? And, you know, there was a substantial amount of time between the War of Independence and the ratification of the Constitution. And during that period, you had the Articles of Confederation, right, against the backdrop of the Declaration of Independence, right? The Declaration of Independence being the original constitutive document for our country, right? Being not merely a polemic, but in fact a source of law. And I'll come back to that in a minute. Okay. Now, under the Articles of Confederation, right, the question of what to do with Indians was kind of a confused mess, but the language of the Articles of Confederation seemed to suggest that the Indians in the states were under the jurisdiction of the states. Right? But another thing happened, right? The key reason for creating the Articles of Confederation was to draw borders. Because you couldn't regulate commerce, right? You couldn't regulate trade unless you had clear borders. And the distinction between landed and unlanded states meant that you had to create something that had never existed before. Right? And what had never existed before was federal territory. Right? So all the land between the borders of the state and the Mississippi River suddenly became territory that was not managed by an individual state, but was managed by this confederation. Now, it wasn't an empty territory, right? So there are people in this territory, and one of the questions was, of course, since these people who are in this territory aren't members of any state, and there really isn't a union as such that can confer citizenship, who are these people? Well, the one thing you know is they're external to the polity, that is, external to the people who are making the decision. Now, national citizenship, I want to come back to national citizenship, save it for last, because maybe it's the most controversial, maybe not. But when dealing with tribes and tribal people, you know, when you study Indian law, and I don't know how many of you studied Indian law, but, you know, take property, right? One of the first cases you read is Johnson against McIntosh. And Johnson against McIntosh, people often read it for questions of property. But there is contained within it a theory of assimilation. Right, so that when Justice Marshall converts discovery to conquest, as he takes you through that process, he takes you through an imagined scenario of what would happen to the people who are conquered. And ultimately, they would be civilized, right, and made capable of joining the Union. And I could quote Justice Marshall. It says, the title by conquest is acquired and maintained by force. The conqueror prescribes its limits. Humanity, as the beginning of the trust duty, by the way, however, acting on public opinion, has established as a general rule that the conquered shall not be wantonly oppressed, and that their condition shall remain as eligible as is compatible with the objects of the conquest. Most usually they are incorporated into the victorious nation and become subjects or citizens of the government with which they are connected. The new and old members of society mingle with each other. The distinction between them is gradually lost, and they make one people. Where this incorporation is practicable, humanity demands it, and wise policy requires. Right. So that he had contained within his description of the contact, right, with the native people at conquest, this idea, ultimately, that his history has shown us that they could, where practicable, be incorporated, but some of them couldn't be. Right? Some of them couldn't be. Now comes what is called in the South, right, the late unpleasantness. And after that unpleasantness, right, there was a ransom that was the Southern states were held to in order to rejoin the Union. Right, and that ransom was the Civil War Amendments. Right, and the Civil War Amendments, and let me read you the 14th Amendment in case you've forgotten its actual text. Right. All persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges and immunities of citizens of the United States Nor shall any state deprive any person of liberty, life, liberty, or property without the due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. Now notice what happened in that. What happened in that? What happened in that was the creation of national citizenship. Right? And what it said is, these people are citizens of where they reside, whether the government wants them to be citizens or not. Okay? It's like saying, if you're living in Great Britain now, you're a citizen of Great Britain, whether Great Britain wants it or not. Now, if we were to do that, what would you say about the sovereignty of Great Britain? You'd say it's diminished, right? Exactly. So, likewise, the sovereignty of the states was, in my view, and not in my view alone, obviously, right, substantially diminished by the ransom that they were held to after the Civil War. Okay? And that the Privileges and Immunities Clause, right, similarly suggests a baseline of national rights that the states cannot abridge. Okay, that the states cannot abridge. So that, in my view, and this is another longer discussion, but this resurgence of our federalism, with which we've got to think about things like citizenship and membership in the polity, is it's a victory of revisionist history, at best, played through politics. Now, where ended all this? So black people were made citizens of the states within which they resided after the Civil War. How about Indians? Well, there's a couple of cases I want to talk about, and then I'll close. Right? So I talked about the vision of assimilation that's there. And so the idea was some Indians, through treaty or otherwise, could be made citizens, and they were, right, or could be assimilated. But then you get the case of Elk against Wilkins. Right? And Elk against Wilkins, of course, is in the news today because of the attacks on birthright citizenship. And this fellow, who had separated from his tribe and went to live in Omaha, tried to register to vote. And he was denied permission to vote. And the reason he was denied permission to vote is that he wasn't a citizen. And he said, but wait, I was born in Nebraska. They said, well, yes, but you were born on a reservation. And if you were born on the reservation, then you were born within the territorial limits of the United States, but not subject to the jurisdiction of the United States. And if the 14th Amendment says that if you're not born subject to the jurisdiction of the United States, then even though you're within the territorial limits of the United States, you are not a citizen of the United States. Thus, tribes, at least at that point, at least on a theoretical level, right, are at a higher level than the states in relationship to the construction of their own polity. Okay? So that you have tribes which are able to define who are their members, right? And Bethany talks about Rogers, maybe in the question and answers. Right? Can define, why is the contrary example, right? Or can define who their members are, right? And their members cannot be made citizens of the United States or citizens of the states within which they reside, because the territory they are in is not part of the states. Right? But what does it mean they're not subject to the jurisdiction of the United States? Well, unclear, right? Because the tribes are clearly subject to federal jurisdiction, right? And federal jurisdiction solely, right, if we take Worcester to be serious, right? And then you get Sandoval, right? In the Sandoval case, you have this whole class of people who are brought into the United States by the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. Right? And the class of people who are brought into the country under the treaty are supposed to have the same juridical relationship with the United States to the federal government as they had to the government of Mexico. Indians in Mexico were citizens. Thus, their juridical relationship to the federal government in the United States, due to the treaty, should be that they are citizens. But wait. If they're citizens, then they're subject to the jurisdiction of the states, right, as well as the federal government. Right? And so the question has to be resolved as to what they are, right? And the in the opinion, one of the interesting things in the opinion, and I think that Sandoval is actually a correlative of the slaughterhouse cases. The slaughterhouse cases, of course, condemn the Privileges and Immunities Clause to the dustbin of history, right? But Sandoval, right, also says that, look, they've got to be Indians and not citizens, because if they're Indians, then we have the plenary power to regulate them. But if they're citizens, then regulating them would be like regulating Italians or Germans, right? And clearly, we can't do that, right? You can still segregate blacks, right, at that point, right? But you can't do that. So we want them to be non-citizens for purposes of exercising federal jurisdiction, which is a weird way to regulate them. And so you have this third class of citizenship, right? You have national citizenship, which is preeminent, a diminished state citizenship, which has, I think, needs to be reconsidered and looked at and dealt seriously with. And then you have this tribal citizenship / membership, all of which define separate peoples. Right? But peoples only make sense at two levels, the tribal level, right, and the national level. Right? Because when I move from California to Texas, I ceased being a Californian, right, and became a Texan by virtue of taking up residence in Texas. Right. When a Navajo moves to another reservation, right, let's say Pine Ridge, he doesn't become Sioux or Lakota, Dakota, right? He may be subject to their jurisdiction, right? But he remains a citizen of the Navajo Nation, right? So it's a different kind of citizenship, and it's one I think we need to take seriously, right? And we need to then organize them thusly, right? So it'd be national citizenship, tribal citizenship, and state citizenship. Right? And we need to say, states matter less than you think.
First of all, I want to thank everybody for putting this together and for inviting me, and I want to thank my friend and colleague, Christina Duffy Burnett, who should have been the speaker here, but she couldn't make it, and she suggested that I come instead, and I'm going to pick on her in just a little bit, so I thought I'd praise her first. Let me start out. I'm going to tell you a story about a man, okay? His name was Jesus Balzac. Okay, and this is going to fit all into the citizenship and most certainly race and sovereignty discussion. Jesus Balzac was the editor of a local newspaper in Arecibo called El Baluarte. Okay, he wrote an article critical of the military colonial government, governor of Puerto Rico at the time in 1918, a guy who happened to be a Princeton classmate of then President Woodrow Wilson, appointed by the president. He then was brought to trial and was criminally prosecuted for seditious libel. Okay, this was 1918, a crime punishable by imprisonment as well as severe fines. So what happens to Mr. Balzac? Okay, he says, because in 1917 the United States gave Puerto Ricans statutory citizenship, and I'll talk about that in a second. He says, I'm a citizen of the United States, and I read my Constitution, and it says in the Sixth Amendment that all crimes shall be by jury. So he demands his jury trial. He doesn't get it. It goes all the way up to the Supreme Court. And I'm going to tell you what happens in a second, but let me back up and give you some context. Okay. Puerto Rico comes into the fold. This is actually very good timing of how the panel was organized, because we, of course, have issues of who is an insider, who's an outsider, who is an alien, who is a citizen from the beginning of the Republic. And then we have, of course, the issues that come later, and the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo and all the other issues that we talked about, and then that Professor Torres talked about. And then in 1898, Puerto Rico's acquired, okay, together with Guam and the Philippines, and protectorate over Cuba as a result of the Spanish-American War. the dynamic here to think about in part, and the way I always think about these things, is people and places. Certain people view these things as places, okay? And therefore they're important because they're military bases or they're places where there are resources. But a lot of times, just like Professor Torres talked about, the federal territory that was created, in those places there are people. And that becomes the fundamental struggle in the Balzac case and several other cases, and still remains a struggle today. Puerto Rico is governed under the Territory Clause of the Constitution, and that means that Congress can regulate that territory and do pretty much what it wants with it. There is a contrary school of thought, and I'll get to that in a second, but this was initially settled in a series of cases back in 1901 through about 19 to the early 20th century, called the Insular Cases. The backdrop and the legal theory that goes with that is called plenary power, which we've talked about, I'm sure you've heard about over the last few days. And plenary power is something the court was very familiar with at the time. There are three components. Professor Cleveland's written a great article that talks about how all this is combined and became part of the doctrine for the foreign relations, national security constitution of the United States, how we look at relations with foreign countries. But there's three components to it that she mentions that I think are dead on right. The first one is an extra constitutional source of authority. In other words, you know, the people who, the use of the plenary power isn't based textually necessarily on the Constitution, but some concept of nationhood without being restricted by the Constitution. Second point is just that, a relative lack of constitutional constraint. And third, which I think is the most damning thing that's happened certainly to Puerto Ricans and certainly as I read Indian law and other things as well to all people of color, is the limited judicial review, the vacating of courts from stepping in and enforcing plain language of Constitution and other texts. So let's talk about race and sovereignty in the context of the acquisitions. I have a very brief, sometimes I think that pictures speak as loudly as words. And this is from a book that Mike Hunt has published, which is excellent. And it shows some of the political cartoons of the day. This is what the concerns were expressed in newspapers and such at the time of the Spanish-American War. Here's another image of the type that was seen at the time. There is President McKinley with his new acquired family sitting there, the children, Puerto Ricans and the others. There, that one says, if General Wood is unpopular in Cuba, we can guess the reason. Okay? Yes, ma'am?
If you go over to from far current. Left on yeah. the screen where it better. Says from beginning
yeah.
from current on the top.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'm almost done.
Okay.
And then this is the last one. Oh, you can't see it at all?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There we go. Is that better? Okay, let me go.
Yes.
There you go. That's an image of what happens if you give the people in these places rights. That's how they're going to petition Congress. Okay. Like I said, there's an image of the new family of President McKinley. Again, they say if he's unpopular in Cuba, we know why. And then one of my favorites that you have to take people kicking and screaming to education, which of course is the exact opposite of what everybody's saying now, that we don't need to be educating people. And that's the book, Michael Hunt, that these particular images, but there are others as well. There's the
kind of images that were in the local papers and media at the time. In addition to that, there's an academic debate leading up to this, and leading up to the Insular Cases, which was extremely high profile and vitriolic. How many people have actually read Balzac versus Puerto Rico, by the way? One, two. Okay, more. Okay, that's more than most law school classes, I think. But the Insular Cases, and the issue, basically what happened is when you take over these new territories, like Puerto Rico, questions emerged immediately. Does the Constitution apply automatically? 14th Amendment citizenship, clearly on the minds of everybody. And if does that mean we've got to give everybody these rights, okay? If not, what is it? It's definitely not a state. Is it like the old territories where the Constitution applies in full, like in Utah? There was a case called Thompson versus Utah, 1898, where they say the Bill of Rights applies in full in the territories. This brought out in the academic debates, there were, that I've counted, 29 articles in the Columbia Law Review, Yale Law Journal, Harvard Law Review, and this sort of thing. And there's a three-part academic debate, okay, and it breaks out as follows. The so-called, to use Professor Gerald Newman's terminology, which I think is very good, the so-called municipal law perspective. These are people who say, that's what the Constitution says, it applies on its own force. The Constitution applies in the territories to all people, to citizens of the United States worldwide, and to aliens outside the U.S. when the United States takes action over there. So in other words, what they basically say, to use the terms of the late 19th century, the Constitution follows the flag. Okay? Then there's the second model, which is called, referred to as the membership model. Only citizens apply, the Constitution applies only to citizens. It's an imperialist model. The Constitution authorizes the holding of colonies overseas, never to give them rights except at the will of the political branches. Plenary power, and the source of that power is the territory. And if they had to pick somewhere in the Constitution, where they would go first is, that's the inherent nature of a country, of a sovereign, is to have the power to take and hold people. And to the extent you have to look at the Constitution, you would look at the territory clause. And then there's the middle of the road, which is frankly where cases ultimately were decided in the insular cases, which is, sure, there's no constitution-free zone, and this is in the Boumediene opinion recently, this has kind of reemerged, but this notion that the Constitution does apply, but not all of the Constitution applies. And of course that makes sense. I mean, there's some things that are purely about apportionment of states that couldn't apply, that sort of thing. But with regards to persons' rights, they say only fundamental rights apply. Well, what's fundamental is in the eye of the beholder. Anyway, so that's the kind of academic framework, which actually was what became the law in the territorial incorporation doctrine in 1901 during the insular cases. And what the court held in two different importation cases is the remarkable proposition that both Puerto Rico is both outside of the United States, but inside the United States. And what they said is it belongs to and is appurtenant to, but is not a part of, the United States. Okay, so you're like, I guess, earrings or belts or whatever is appurtenant to you, but isn't really part of you. It brings up an interesting issue of Americans in waiting. So that's what happened in 1901. And then the debates also had this kind of imagery in them. They said, for instance, our Constitution was made by a civilized and educated people. To give the half-civilized moros of the Philippines, or even the ignorant and lawless brigands that infest Puerto Rico, or even the ordinary Filipino of Manila, the benefit of such immunity from the sharp and sudden justice or injustice which they've been accustomed to would be a serious obstacle to the maintenance of efficient government. That's the kind of language going on in the academic debates. Okay, so there's a series of these opinions. And then Balzac comes to the court in 1922. Going back to what I had said earlier, this is the man who exercised his right to criticize the colonial government and put things in perspective. The Bill of Rights was originally the most anti-colonial portion of the Constitution. The history was, if you take the case of John Peter Zenger, which is virtually very similar to Balzac's case, he was criticizing the local governor, but he got a jury. Balzac did not. So then the question becomes, okay, in 20 years since the insular cases to when Balzac comes before the court, Puerto Ricans had been granted citizenship in 1917. There had been a case called Gonzalez versus Williams where the court said she is not an alien. Ms. Gonzalez is not an alien. So she's a national. Well, that's nice, but what does that mean when I'm a national but I'm not a citizen? Can I get a passport? What am I? A big ambiguity created until the Jones Act of 1917. So Mr. Balzac says, now that I'm a citizen, if you believe this territorial incorporation doctrine that there has to be an attempt by Congress to incorporate a territory in order for it to apply, certainly the Jones Act granting citizenship and everything that's happened in between 1901 and 1922 did that. Well, the Supreme Court said no. And the reason I think Balzac is so significant is not only that they reinforced the territorial incorporation doctrine, which had actually been, and this is kind of lawyer kind of speak, but it had been a plurality opinion. There had been only four justices voting for that. It had been a 5-4 opinion in favor of the particular holding, but there had only been four people agreeing with that theory. But in 1922, under Chief Justice William Taft, it was a 9-0 opinion, so it was a unanimous Supreme Court. So what were the arguments and what were the justifications for denying this man his Sixth Amendment jury trial right? They gave four. Number one, orderly administration of justice. It would provoke disturbances to have a jury system and have this man have to go in front of a jury. Well, how is that different than California or Texas or any other civil, Louisiana, any other civil code jurisdiction? Number two, they said they had deference and respect to the colonies and their legal system and traditions. Well, whenever an opinion starts going down that road, you pretty much have a sense of where it's going to end up, and it's sort of the kiss of death. So with everything else that had been going on, the restrictions on the speaking of the Spanish language, a number of other anti-local laws, this seems a pretty far-fetched theory. And the third and fourth ones were that an effective jury system requires citizens trained to be responsible jurors, and it takes a lot of time in order to be trained in that. Well, a couple things. First of all, if you're somebody who just had never been on jury duty before, or you're 18 years old, not then, you haven't had centuries of training in becoming a jury. Also, in Puerto Rico, there have been federal juries since 1899. So that, again, is kind of a bizarre rationale. And the last one they gave was that jury trials are remedial and not fundamental. And if you think about it, what is more fundamental than due process? And what process is due? The one to be tried in accordance with the fundamental rights, including the right to trial by jury. There's been a case in Duncan versus Louisiana in 1968 and a bunch of others that call into question whether this would remain the law if posed exactly the same. But I submit to you it is, and there's been a case in the double jeopardy context, in other words, where somebody had been prosecuted by the federal government and then the government of Puerto Rico wanted to prosecute them. And there was a split of opinion. One way, the First Circuit said that Puerto Rico is a sovereign now, because in 1952 there was a Commonwealth Constitution created, which some people say is a compact between the people of Puerto Rico and the people of the United States that's can't be violated and so on and so forth. Those of us on the other side of that argument believe that it's an act of Congress, and like every other act of Congress, it can be superseded by another act of Congress. And therefore, Puerto Rico is still governed under the Territory Clause of the Constitution. And that's exactly what the 11th Circuit said in their case, saying this man cannot be held twice in jeopardy because he's already been effectively held in jeopardy by the federal government. I see that I'm running a little bit short on time, very short on time. I'll talk about some of the other issues maybe on rebuttal, but let me just mention that I think the issue of jury trials is another one that I would invite you to think about a little bit in the context of sovereignty. Because if you look at the history of civil rights litigation, whether you go Strotter versus West Virginia, Hernandez versus Texas, Hernandez versus New York, JEB versus Alabama, jury service and jury duty is like voting, one of the few things that distinguish citizens from non-citizens. And I think there's really a campaign to disenfranchise people right now, certainly at the voting booth and also through jury service. So.
Fabulous UCLA people that put on this conference, and particularly to Addy, who, I mean, I think for those of us that have been writing in related fields for years, kind of feel like, hey, a field is being created here, and I think we can give a lot of credit to Addy for doing that, and as you can see, she's produced this beautiful baby while doing all this, so big congratulations, and thank you. So, You know, over the last 2 days, we've been interrogating the dichotomies between race and sovereignty. In this panel particularly, we're supposed to be interrogating apparent dichotomies between inclusion and exclusion. And in talking about this, I want to add a couple other dichotomies that I think play a role, dichotomies between individual and group, and dichotomies between citizens and state. And I want to say that I think that these apparent dichotomies are in part the result of defining racism and sovereignty in particularly limited terms. So racism, in this common narrow definition, is what happens to individuals. Its means are excluding the individual from society, and its cure perhaps is full citizenship, not simply formal citizenship. Sovereignty, or in this narrow definition, is often seen as exclusive control over a fixed territory through a centralized legal system, and its cure is full statehood, the denial of sovereignty. In these definitions of sovereignty and racism, Indian tribes are neither sovereigns, nor are they consistently the victims of racism. And through these definitions, contemporary current attempts to restore sovereignty to Indian tribes are themselves racist and incoherent in the face of the citizenship and demands for individual equality of tribal members. And as you can guess, I'm going to challenge those things. But I want to say, before doing that, I want to say that while I'm going to focus on American Indians, I don't think that American Indians are the exception that proves the value of the dichotomies. I think in the work today, and we can see that, just to highlight a few things, work by Carol Anderson and others have brought out how attempts to link domestic racism and denials of full sovereignty in the development of the UN were forcibly quashed. I think Hiroshi, Laura Gomez's work, Carlos's paper, help us see the ways that judgments regarding the nature of the sovereign of origin, or the sovereign that's being colonized, affect racist denials, what we look at as individual racism. Tomiko Brown talks about how what's understood as the hallmark of anti-racism, the struggle for integration of schools, a strategy of inclusion, was to a great extent chosen by elites in the NAACP, and sometimes against the will of African-American parents and communities who might at times have preferred a strategy of not necessarily sovereignty, but self-determination through the improving of African-American schools. And I think Robin is going to continue this by showing how African-American struggles for or movements for self-determination have been overlooked through these paradigmatic understandings of racism. So I'm going to do four things. I'm going to talk about how the Indian tribe was racialized as a means of denying tribe sovereignty while American Indians were forcibly included as part of that project, how the extension of citizenship to American Indians goes within that project. Finally, the ways modern accusations of racism and incoherence of sovereignty and U.S. citizenship are used to undermine current efforts to overcome the racist denials of sovereignty, and hopefully talk about hopeful development, the way the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples begins to overcome these dichotomies, offers an alternative vision. And everything I'm going to say is a generalization, so it's not true for all Indian peoples at all times. In particular, it's often not true for the peoples of this area, of California, and of the people whose land we're on, the Tongva, the Tataviam, and the Chumash, who not only were denied sovereignty in a much more complete way than many tribes experienced, but also faced Jim Crow laws to a much greater extent than many other Indian peoples. So first, racism and inclusion in Indian tribes. One of the ways that the Americans defined themselves as a superior race was through their ability to absorb and overcome the racial and ethnic particularities of those that they absorbed. There were clearly groups that were deemed unable to be absorbed at different times, but American Indians were not among them. Instead, the assimilation of Indians into the American mainstream was not only a relatively cheap means to destroy the tribe, but was a confirmation of the ultimate justice of the colonial project. This process was not only cultural, but physical and sexual. So willing female attachment to and domination of by the white man reenacted colonial domination of Indian lands, this time inscribed on the bodies of the races. And for this reason, miscegenation laws only rarely applied to American Indians, and relationships between particularly Indian women and white men, when they led to the assimilation of the women, were celebrated in popular culture. Other laws and practices understood to draw the color line were only inconsistently applied to Indians. Philip DeLoria's great example is that in the 1910 World Series, American Indian players played on both of the opposing teams. Indian tribes, in contrast, were understood to be fixed in their racial status. They had some authority over internal affairs of their members, but little else, and they were frozen in inferior customs and traditions. They were therefore denied full sovereign recognition, and American policy was directed towards destroying tribes altogether. American Indian individuals could only escape this permanent racial condemnation by renouncing their tribes. Second, citizenship. This dual process, racializing the tribe while celebrating the absorption of the Indian individual, changes the significance of citizenship in American Indian policy. To refer to Dred Scott again, even as it infamously says, even as citizenship was withheld from African Americans, it was being extended to American Indians as a reward for renouncing allegiances to the tribe, as a reward for civilization. So treaties offered citizenship to those who accepted federal conditions to abandon their tribes, who would swear an oath of allegiance to the United States, or could prove that they'd adopted the habits of civilized life, and would dissolve their tribal relations. Some treaties even extend citizenship to and dissolve entire tribes. After the end of treaty making, this was done through statutes. And later, these statutes were extended to people because even against their affirmative choice to Indians that accepted their allotments, to Indian women that married white men. Underscoring these different uses of exclusion and exclusion, 1924, the year that Congress declared all Indians born in the United States to be citizens, was the same year it completed its prohibition on all Asian immigration. So what was Native individuals' attitude towards this? Some Native individuals did sincerely want citizenship. Others either actively resisted or were indifferent to it. Citizenship was initially understood by both settler communities and Native communities as anathema to the goal of self-government, as stripping the individual of an immunity from foreign laws, stripping the tribe of claims to sovereignty over their members. Many of the tribes, or some of the tribes that accepted citizenship, later successfully petitioned Congress to take it away and restore their tribal status. By the 1924 extension of citizenship, again, the reports say most Indians were indifferent to it. Some, particularly California Indian groups, were actively advocating for it, and some, like the Haudenosaunee, were actively resisting it. But as colonization had destroyed the ability of tribes to provide independent economic, educational, and social support to their members, citizenship became crucial to American Indian individuals. So this reality of citizenship for American Indians has created a powerful contemporary means of arguing that tribes cannot be full sovereigns. That there is an incoherence between tribal sovereignty and contemporary citizenship and demands for equality as state citizens. Similarly, tribes, as they try to restore their sovereignty, are subject to claims of racism as well, because tribal membership or citizenship is often dependent on tribal heritage. The claim is that recognizing tribal sovereignty is itself racist. And so, ironically, the measures that seek to correct the racist denial of sovereignty to American Indian tribes are today being attacked as racist. I would say that these attacks, in some degree, replicate old assertions that tribes are not true governments but instead racial groups, repackaged for modern consumption. As we try to think of the alternatives to these destructive patterns, the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples offers some alternatives. It's not coincidental, as Professor Lam described yesterday, that this document was not primarily drafted by state actors, but instead by indigenous peoples themselves. And as Rebecca Sosi pointed out, the innovation of the document is not only that it recognized rights of self-determination in indigenous peoples, but it interweaves rights commonly understood as belonging to individuals and rights commonly understood as belonging to groups. Rights of individual equality, rights of freedom from discrimination, and rights of self-determination and recognition and protection of culture. It repeatedly insists on the rights of indigenous peoples to both self-determination, freedom of discrimination, recognizing that the two are not inconsistent, but two sides of the same coin, of dignity, of equality, of human flourishing. As Professor Lam described, this was not an easy document to get through, but in 2007 it was finally approved by an overwhelming majority of the General Assembly, of the UN General Assembly, 143-4 with 11 abstentions, and the 4 no votes with the U.S.'s finally signing on in December 2010 have now all agreed to support the declaration. Again, it's going to be implemented by the states and through the fora they themselves created, and so its implementation is likely to be incomplete and distorted. But it does offer some possibilities for re-envisioning the relationships between individual group and group, between inclusion and exclusion, and even between race and sovereignty at a time when I think such possibilities are desperately needed. So 1 minute and I am done.
Can you hear me? Okay, great. I'll sit up here and do this. First of all, like everyone else, I have to thank the organizers for bringing me to this event, surrounded by all these brilliant thinkers, and I could follow most of them, because I'm not a lawyer. I don't even understand the law, as even it applies to me. I have to especially thank Cheryl Harrison, Kim Crenshaw, for always believing in me that I could actually hang, so we'll see what happens. And then also, before I begin, let me just dedicate my remarks this afternoon very briefly to the late Manning Marable, who passed away a couple days ago. His book, Malcolm X, A Life of Reinvention, actually is due out tomorrow. So it's kind of tragic and sad, but you know, thinking about Manning and thinking about Malcolm X, who kind of embodies many of the tensions and possibilities in both self-determination and rights-based claims. I think it's an interesting memory to kind of have looming over us as we talk about these things. Much of what I'd hoped to say was actually said in the last plenary, which was great, by the way. And it was actually not said during the plenary, it was said in the Q&A. And so I'm going to try not to repeat much of what was said, but echo some of that. My intention this afternoon, as I said in my ticket of admission, was to kind of trouble the presumption that, quote, traditionally in the U.S. domestic context, rights-based claims by Black, Asian, and Latino communities have been framed as demands for civil rights and for inclusion, while conversely, indigenous communities' struggles have been cast as demands for self-determination against forced inclusion in dominant nation states. And I'm not the only one doing this. Clearly, everyone on this panel and previous panels have tried to trouble this dichotomy. What I'm doing, though, which is a little different, I'm focusing on social movements. So it's not really about exclusion as much as struggles for transformation, inclusion, change. And what ended up happening with my talk is I, because of all these interesting conversations and terrific panels, I started to accumulate marginal notes, and they started to make their way into the talk as a consequence. And so I went from having a really coherent talk to something that's a little bit less coherent, but I think more interesting. So I'm going to respond to some of these while I give my talk. Okay. Now, while I reject exceptionalism, I do embrace historical specificity and understand differences within and between groups as part of a single narrative. That said, there is a fundamental difference between being part of an ongoing multi-generational immigration and maintaining some ties, however limited, to one's home country and being designated property in the descendants of property derived through violent expropriation, kidnapping, and forced transportation across the ocean. Now, of course, we all know that the transatlantic slave trade rendered nearly impossible the maintenance of direct cultural, linguistic, familial connections to the place of origins. But it also meant that Africans had no recognized sovereign states to which to turn, to intervene on their behalf. They were never recognized as citizens anywhere, as ever having citizens, having been citizens of nations, despite the loose term used on plantations like nations and tribes and countrymen to group Africans in categories. And while European powers also used treaties in Africa to generate allies, claim land rights, rivers, ports, safe passes, trade, foment division, there is no evidence that any treaty or similar document applied to the condition of enslaved people taken across the water. So let me echo Melinda Lowry's comment this afternoon that dispossession and slavery cannot be treated separately, and also echo Ajoa Ayatoro's observation that Africans also experience dispossession from the land. Cheryl and I were just talking about this yesterday about how we think of dispossession as being in a part of indigenous experience, but dispossession is very much about the slave trade as well. Perhaps I'm old-fashioned, but I tend to think of dispossession / expropriation as a global process. We could read David Harvey, but I'm like, read Marx's chapter on primitive accumulation. Consider our discussions thus far of settler colonialism and the silence around the fact that enclosure and criminalization helped produce the foot soldiers, the pioneers of settler colonial rule in North America and Australia. In this kind of sidebar, I was curious about the debate about settler colonialism because, and I think Patrick Wolf would agree with me, tell me if I'm wrong about this, it is an old concept that's been revitalized because we were studying this in grad school here at UCLA. I mean, on my reading list, Kenneth Good, George Jabor, Donald Danoon, settler capitalism, we're reading all this stuff in the late 70s, early 80s. And then it comes back with a vengeance. And it emerged, if you remember, in tandem with internal colonialism as a concept. And it applied to, my understanding is, applied to colonial societies with significant settler populations from the metropole, usually backed by metropolitan capital and resources. So you have multi-generational, sometimes multi-generational, quote-unquote, settlers who end up developing political identities distinct from the metropole, Kenya, southern Rhodesia, South Africa, Australia, Algeria, etc. In many of these cases, though, of course, these were not cases where the settler population actually fought for independence from home rule, but in fact was backed by. Now, getting back to the heart of the matter, my argument is that black movements over the past two centuries, one, have not been traditionally rights-based nor universally fighting for inclusion. In fact, these movements have been diverse, fraught with internal differences and disagreements, and very dynamic. And they've often embraced both rights-based arguments and demands for self-determination simultaneously, and ideological, tactical, and strategic shifts have to be understood in specific historical context. So when they do shift, it's not willy-nilly. It has to do with the conditions of struggle. And in this case, I kind of echo Devin Carbato and Professor Lamb's argument that self-determination in some ways really works even better than sovereignty for this particular case. And so for many of the 20th century black movements, I just want to add one little historical footnote. the concept of self-determination derives less from the United Nations 1945 document and more from two sources, Woodrow Wilson and Lenin. Okay, so you got to go back really to 1917, and after that, where, you know, on the one hand, people are drawing on Woodrow Wilson's notion of self-determination, which is not the not the exact concept that African Americans wanted to use, but Lenin in particular, and the way that the Soviet Union developed a model for dealing with quote-unquote oppressed nationalities was picked up by a lot of black movements in the 1920s and 30s, which we could talk about. Throughout the 19th and 20th centuries, movements for black self-determination, independence, immigration have coexisted with demands for basic civil rights, sometimes within the same movement. And in fact, if we widen our scope even further, I think we might include marinage as a strategy, an early strategy. You have maroon societies, which are assertions of sovereignty and self-determination, but not governed by European rights discourse and not governed by European sort of state formation. Jamaica is an interesting challenge to this, and we could talk about that. But maroon societies also trouble the way modern identity politics shapes our discussion because they were not always African in makeup. In fact, maroons included renegade Europeans, indigenous people, Africans, and to be honest, in the 17th century, or 16th century, 17th, 18th, these categories I just named, European, African, they didn't even exist. You know, that doesn't even work for them. So that itself is an imposition. African hadn't really been invented yet as a self name. There are countless instances where the demands for basic civil rights, recognition of citizenship, dignity, and respect were promoted by the same organizations, individuals, pushing for the creation of independent space, territory, institutions, as well as international recognition as a suppressed nation or a people with the inherent right of self-determination. Let me give you some examples. Of course, the largest mass movement in the history of African America wasn't a rights-based movement, but it was Marcus Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association, an organization that shunned civil rights discourse in favor of a return to a sovereign/decolonized Africa. Garvey's movement ultimately called for an indemnity to be paid by European nations to Africa for the ravages of slavery and colonialism. And in fact, for many black nationalist organizations in the U.S., 20th century, post-Garvey reparations has been really a central demand, often framed in terms of human rights discourse. So you have organizations like the 49th State Movement, for example. And the African Nationalist Independent Partition Party of North America, both advocated reparations in the form of land on which to create a black state. The latter's, quote, Declaration of Self-Determination of the African American Captive Nation, issued January of 1963, argued for restitution in the form of, quote, all land south of the Mason-Dixon line, where our people constitute the majority, that it be partitioned to establish a territory for self-government for the African nation in the United States. And of course, there's no acknowledgement at all of native territory, native claims to land in this case. There's too many examples to discuss here, and I won't, but it is worth looking at, say, the Black Manifesto issued in 1969 that demanded $500 billion in reparations to be paid by white Christian churches and later by synagogues. Essentially, the idea behind the Black Manifesto, reparations, was to fund a black socialist agenda with the long-term objective of transforming the U.S. and the world. And some examples, they wanted to use money to create a land bank, to create cooperative farms, a national black labor strike fund. They wanted to use money to build research and educational centers and black-owned media, and to use the funds to support the National Welfare Rights Organization, organizing on rights based inside the United States, and to support African liberation movements, you know. So we can go on. I mean, the Republic of New Africa demanded that the U.S. government hand over 5 southern states to African Americans, and the RNA would establish a government in exile. And again, like the African Nationalist Independence Partition Party, there was no initial recognition of native land claims. the final point I want to make, because I know time is short, is that so many social black social movements expressed a third path, one that doesn't fall under self-determination and doesn't fall easily under rights-based claims for inclusion, but rather, and this is the unacknowledged formulation, that is a path for what we might call transformational politics. That is to say, a central theme of black movements have not been to beg for inclusion through extension of basic rights, but to transform the country and its social, cultural, political, economic, and juridical institutions shaped by a new vision of society, one that would reformulate rights, privileges, commitments, and recast the role of the state, not just for black people, but for the entire nation. So I'm going to give three quick examples. Reconstruction. Freed people were the catalysts who won their freedom by bringing the Confederacy down. And they brought with them a vision of the of society and the role of the state that they hope would, you know, substantially transform the society they lived in and was so different from their masters and northern capitalists. So for them, the role of the state should be provide economic support to those in need, provide protect the citizens from violence and exploitation, provide good education, housing, public services. In fact, free public education was one of the great victories of free people coming out of Reconstruction, to work actively to achieve and defend equality, and to seize land from former rebels, knowing that they broke the law by waging war, and distribute that land to free people as reparations for unpaid wages. The second one, post-Reconstruction, where interracial radicalism, movements like the Knights of Labor, the Greenback Labor Party, populism, were really at the heart of a lot of black struggles for justice, and these were interracial movements. T. Thomas Fortune wrote a book called Black and White, which I suggest everyone read in 1884. It's one of the first interesting kind of black-authored socialist texts, where he basically calls for, he's calling for a return to the commons, if you will. An end to land monopoly. And for him, the arguments are not just about black people, but for the nation as a whole. Finally, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party was not fighting for the inclusion of black voters in body politics. That wasn't the only thing. It was rather to transform the Democratic Party in Mississippi and the nation, and to have a very different agenda. And just very quickly, the MFDP's platform in 1968, which we know more about their struggle for inclusion in the DNC, and yes, about the less about the platform, but if you look at the platform, they were calling for things like a guaranteed annual income, extended daycare for all for free, comprehensive medical care, increased federal provisions for food stamp programs, free higher education, I repeat that, free higher education, end to the Vietnam War, an end to compulsory military draft, renewed diplomatic ties to Cuba and China, embargo on arms to South Africa and the Middle East. And this is the kind of stuff. So if I had a conclusion, it would really be to appeal to all of us to push past the kind of rights, slash inclusion versus sovereignty binary, which I think ultimately, I think most people here in this forum have really been doing that, and that's why it's very exciting. I say push even further and consider transformative politics as fundamental to challenge the very frameworks of human rights, which still seem to be locked in Enlightenment discourse, and sovereignty, which still rooted in ideas of nation state, citizenship, and borders. But in the end, I do think there's something to transformative politics coming out of transformative social movements. And it requires a politics of empathy, a politics not based on perceived self-interest, but a radical shift from belonging to, I think, what Dr. Martin Luther King calls a beloved community. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
I know it's been a practice in some of these panels for the moderator to use this time right now to address further questions to the panelists, but I have a feeling that you all have been challenged and inspired by what you've all heard, and it's probably time right now to begin your questions for the panelists. So please step forward to the microphones. or phone. I guess there's only one.
Well, I'll go because I can't resist. It was a really fabulous panel. And I just want to say you can definitely hang if that was your question at the outset. I would say more than hang. So I'm going to try to reduce all my thoughts down to something sort of brief that I think any of you could speak to. And it's this, really, how to pull these themes together and pull back in, and I think I'm really maybe thinking of your last comments, Robin, to an economic critique, which, as you suggest, is old-fashioned and clearly now very unfashionable. And so I don't want to engage in too much sort of academic wishful thinking, but here we are. And so here I'll give a few thoughts I had, and then you can react to them in that light. So the story of settler colonialism also pulls in a public land story I always think about whenever people talk about this, which is that those intending citizens' rules, of course, applied to immigrants who could be sent out west largely to fail, you know, at a 60% rate of failure. And so that story, which of course dispossessed native peoples and at first excluded slaves, then later included some slaves who saw that as a route to freedom, you know, to come to Kansas and the territories and so forth. But then there's a story on top of that, so this feeds back into the economic critique question, which is that, of course, the 60% failure rate meant that all that land and territory really went to a handful of folks, railroads, you know, and other capitalist monopolists. And so that's another layer of the dispossession and marginalization that I think puts us all in the position of all these trying to pull all these different stories of subordination together at the end of the day, which seemed to me always to be all about who has access to the stuff or who controls the pie. So I'll stop there and just see what the reactions are.
Please, go ahead.
You're obviously right.
Along with these stories, right? If you grew up in the Midwest or spent any time in the Midwest, right? What you come across are people, street urchins in New York were collected, right, and sent to the Midwest in boxcars, right, to provide free labor for the farms in the Upper Midwest, right? And so the dispossessed among us, right, of all races, right, was mainly class, right, were fed into the maw that you just described, right. And for those of us who I teach environmental law. So when you teach environmental law, and you teach about the national parks or the federal lands, what you have to teach about, right, is the dispossession of native people from those areas to create the things that we consider the gems of our culture, right? The natural cathedrals that rival those in Europe, right? Mm-hmm. To quote the founding of the national parks, right? And all of this contributes to that. The assembly of resources for, and then you have to answer for whom, right? And the reason I gave you this kind of fantasy version of citizenship that I gave you, right, was to suggest that if you take the Privileges and Immunities Clause seriously, or the Declaration of Independence seriously, now it is an Enlightenment, rooted in the Enlightenment vision, right? But it also means that there's a baseline that states that you can use against states. Right, and how you use it against states and what that means contemporarily, right, will include some of the things that you just mentioned,
or ought to. Right, right. Yeah, I just throw in a couple of things. One is that the issue of reparations is interesting because the argument for reparations, and actually you could address this more than me, throughout the 20th century, hasn't simply been redress. It's also been about two things. One, making an argument that people's poverty is not the result of bad behavior or not working hard enough, but a product of exploitation. And it kind of reverses the poles by making visible where capital comes, where wealth comes from. And that this is a transfer of wealth which is just. And part of the argument for the most sophisticated arguments I've ever seen have been saying, look, you know, if you have a massive transfer of wealth to urban areas that have been predominantly, say, black in the past, it's not as if those are the only folks who are going to benefit. Everyone benefits. Everyone who has been dispossessed will benefit. Everyone who's been underpaid and exploited benefits from that. And then the second thing is, just not about reparations, but what I didn't have time to mention was the fact that in trying to explain the gap in the 19th century between the end of Reconstruction and then disfranchisement, and again, the legal scholars may contest this, there's about a 15-year gap between, you know, 1890 and, say, you know, 1877, 1875, right? So what is that gap about? Well, and then also the rise of lynching. So lynching really takes off in the 1890s more so than the 1870s and 80s. Why is that? Because in the 1870s and 80s, you continue to have the last breath of multiracial, working class-based organizing around the last vestiges of the Radical Republican Party and these other new movements. And so part of that is the suppression of the possibility of other dispossessed people coming together in struggle in opposition to the old planter class. And so it's a kind of, there's a moment of redemption that took at least 15 years of struggle to basically win, and they never really won, because then you have Wilmington in 1898. So you have this whole period of intense struggle. And my point is that if we keep looking for so-called minority groups or subjugated groups within the confines of like race-only organizations and that sort of thing, we're going to miss where they are. Many of them are in these organizations, leading these organizations, mine workers, populist movement, that sort of thing. But they get written out because somehow biracial, multiracial organizing ends up becoming predominantly white in terms of its conception, but that's not always the case.
And just to add in a couple of thoughts, and of course, as Cheryl Harris has written about, I mean, you could write about the treatment of all racial groups in the U.S. In relation to their particular relationship to property and to stuff people want. And you could look at the recognition of at least partial sovereignty in Indian tribes, because it was easier to say, if you could say that some tribe consented to you having the land, then you could back up your own property claims to it. And this brings up what Carol brought up at the beginning, that, you know, at different moments, any group may have some access to property, and so that leads to contests between groups about who gets to regulate that access to property. And just to bring this back from the more, to tie in the commercial and the governmental and the familial, I mentioned miscegenation laws as being the hallmark of racism, and of course we all know that miscegenation laws didn't mean there weren't sexual relationships between the races. It just meant that no property rights could come from those sexual relationships. You couldn't get married, you couldn't inherit, and just you know,
along that point, I mean, there are pockets of resistance. Like when you start to look for resistance, right, it's actually everywhere to be seen. Right, and it's resist. It's you know, Milani and I were working on the book. We went out and interviewed people all around the country, right? Because what you discover is that if you just look at the national level, it looks like, you know, it's the Council of Despair, right? Nothing is happening, right? But if you go to the local level, like there's stuff happening everywhere in the country. There's stuff happening everywhere, and people know that if they come together, they can work. And a lot of them, like in the EJ movement, the environmental justice movement, those are multiracial movements, right? Those are multiracial movements because you know when you're being poisoned and you know where political power is, right? And when you don't have it, right? And so that's one of the, see, you can find them, right? They're out there, right? Like in Texas, in the miscegenation, right? The children of these mixed marriages, when the patriarch would die, would often sue, claiming the marriage was invalid because the woman was black, and since miscegenation was illegal, she couldn't inherit, and they would get the wealth. Well, the way Texas judges got around it was, a lot of times this woman was from Mexico. And so they would ask, well, what was she considered in Mexico? And since in Mexico they didn't recognize race as a juridical category, she was Mexican. And marriage between whites and Mexicans were actually permitted, right? And so she got to inherit, right? And so you see, even you got pockets of judges resisting in that way, right? And it's out there, right? And like, because the part of the tradition that we live in is a tradition of resistance, and we need to reclaim the tradition of resistance, right? I mean, that's really, really critical.
They're resisting even in Texas.
Even in Texas. God forfend.
Further questions, please.
I'd like to suggest that another dichotomy that we really need to trouble is the dichotomy between migrants and the indigenous. And I think that the way that this title of race sovereignty has been coded is that race is for migrants to, let's say, if we're just talking about the United States, to people who migrated here, and sovereignty is a concern for people who are indigenous to what is now the United States. And I think that if we're going to take very seriously the proposition that dispossession is a global phenomenon, which I would wholeheartedly agree we need to take seriously, and if we are going to also see as a remedy to global dispossession a commons, which I would also really support, is what does the commons today look like, I think, is a key question. What is the scale of the commons? Who are the commoners today? You know, this, you know, if we're going to take seriously the fact, and I'm thinking of Sylvia Winter's work that Professor Lowe talked about this morning, you know, one of the things that Sylvia Winter pointed out in that, you know, germinal essay that she wrote about 1492 was that the new world that was created was not just the new world as represented by Columbus and his backers, but it was also a new world that brought together all of the dispossessed, displaced peoples of the planet, sometimes in very radical formations. So my question perhaps is to Professor Kelly, could you talk about the commons today, what that looks like, and particularly what that looks like in relationship to indigenous claims to sovereignty today? Because I think that there is a pushback on the concept of the commons from people who are saying the commons is just another form of expropriation, right? That what we should do is return the commons that were stolen from the indigenous peoples of what we now call the United States back to tribal formations rather than through more expansive notions of the commons and who the commoners are.
See, that's a hard question. It's a hard question because, you know, what I say will depend on whether I get out of here. First of all, my understanding of the commons comes so much out of my own reading in both English social history, but specifically Peter Linebaugh, who wrote this wonderful book called Magna Carta Manifesto. It's very idiosyncratic, but right on, I think, in terms of trying to think about law and where the sort of the radical history and radical potential of the Magna Carta. And it's interesting because T. Thomas Fortune in Black and White, that's one of his main documents, Magna Carta. And he's making a case as a black radical born in slavery for a kind of return to the commons, but he's also influenced by Henry George and the idea that, you know, you have a kind of land tax and that you tax land to such an extent that if it's not productive, that whoever owns it would lose revenue and therefore force kind of collective use. In terms of the larger question, it's probably a combination of both. I mean, you know, I tend to move towards a more expansive notion of the commons, but then when my understanding, my mom, who does Native American studies, she's right here, she could probably speak to this. My understanding is that, and maybe I'm wrong about this, is that the notions of private property and land and wealth accumulation were not sort of native to to the new. In fact, they weren't native to Europe before. You know, these are new formations, and so if I'm correct, then the combination of a kind of recognition and return, and the transformation of land, property, energy into use for all does not counter indigenous claims. In fact, it means that indigenous people would be participating as collective owners of those resources and help to make decisions about distribution. You know, and that's part of it. The other part is that so much of what, you ask what is the common, so much of it is not even land. It's things like access to education. It's things like energy, water. I mean, we've been living through such an intense period of privatization in my lifetime. I mean, I could even remember things that were not so privatized as they are now. So I think part of the challenge to roll that back is also to, it be in dialogue with indigenous peoples, who not always, but sometimes have a conception of land use, property use, energy use, that could be in concert with a kind of collective discussion about how we transform society, if that makes sense.
This is a very different sort of an answer, but I was thinking about Robin's last few sentences about the commons and what it consists of, and it's broader than what you might initially think. And I was thinking about that third version of sovereignty that I tried to articulate in my remarks on the state and local. And it's been interesting to think about the various avenues of attempts to regulate migration to this country. And here I want to say that I agree with your starting point about how it's important to break through these dichotomies, but I think a lot of this conversation has been about how race and sovereignty do not dichotomize in that way. So, but it's been interesting to think about migration regulation with regard to access to commons. I hadn't quite thought of it phrased in that way, but I think it makes a lot of sense. If you look at the regulation or the attempts to restrict immigration at the state and local level, and sort of what I characterize as the sort of the return to Dred Scott, it's been interesting to see the ebb and flow of how that regulation has, to some extent, regulated migration directly. And so that is sort of like what I would call, in the context of this conference, sort of the direct imposition of sovereignty at the border. But it's interesting to see how the movements in the last, say, 40 years to regulate immigration when local communities don't want certain people have always been to target what I think we're now, just in the last 5 minutes, talking about aspects of the commons, right? And so it is education, for example. That's Plyler versus Doe. It is housing. That's Hazleton. It is employment. That's Arizona Legal Workers Act, and so forth. And so and that really... So that's just an observation, but it's also a legal argument in the sense that this is why the indirect regulations that I just described are as troubling as direct regulations, because it's an attack on access to the commons, not just a traditional question of border.
I'm going to get out of here, but
I want to be clear. Everyone will get out of here safely. That's just baseline understanding. Okay, this is California. Remember, Rebecca Sosi said it's good not to be in Arizona saying this stuff, and I kind of got the feeling from you, Gerald, that maybe it was good to be not in Texas saying some of this stuff. So we're all cool here.
I mean, just to
all y'all.
This is. I'm putting my property professor hat on a little bit, which I don't usually do in Indian law as much, but the commons in England, the commons, the way it successfully worked, is not open access. It's you figure out what is the community that can share in them, and they join in managing them and managing them efficiently. And that's true of native property rights. That's true of every property system we see. And I would actually challenge the notion that that kind of commons doesn't exist in the United States now. It's just the beneficiaries, for example, in the Homestead Act, are the railroads. It's like, aha, there's land open, who gets it? When there is land that there is property claims on, what is the class of groups that we can, individuals that, or entities that we can say can share that? But it's a more difficult problem to think about if we are going to, and I think creating commons is incredibly valuable, and but it does pose hard questions of who can participate in that commons, and it certainly shouldn't be those who can participate now, but we need to work on those problems of community.
I don't disagree with that. I think, to me, the question of the commons is very much like the question of reparations. It's not something that you actually would achieve, but in making the claim, you're trying to revise the way we understand things like private property exploitation, privatization. We're in a period right now where we're told that to privatize and to make and produce more wealth accumulation for a small group actually produces jobs. It doesn't make any sense. And so part of it to me is like the debate, it's exactly what you say, it's the debate. It's the engagement on the question of what is our history. I think it's a mistake to be kind of romantic and say, well, we could take the small scale modes of, chopping down trees, for example, and available timber and that sort of thing, which is very much the English commons and the moral economy, and then apply that to kind of national global scale. Part of it is also saying that this is not a national question, but it's a global question. It really is a global question, and it's about the way that we, living in North America, benefit from the exploitation privatization in ways that people outside of North America, the exploitation benefits us. And those kinds of questions, I think, will force us to rethink the economy and our place in it.
So. Really, really short, because you have a question. First of all, putting my property professor hat on too, right? Like the public trust doctrine is actually a real doctrine, right? And we ought to explore it. But the second thing is, with the debate about cap and trade, right, the question that ought to come to all of your minds is who owns the sky, right? Mm. Right? Who owns the carbon loading capacity of the atmosphere? Who ought to profit from the carbon loading capacity of the atmosphere? And my argument is that everyone who breathes, uh-huh, right, has a claim in the clean part of the atmosphere, and the people who are profiting from the trading of the pollution loading part, right, ought to pay us, not necessarily the state, us, right? Each one of you, right, who breathes, has a claim to the profit they're making off of using your resource.
Okay, last question, because we're getting close to the end of our session here.
Okay, thank you. I just want to first say this was a wonderful panel. And I'm glad that you raised the idea of transformative politics. And I think it bridges some of what was said in the last plenary to this plenary, when we're talking about whether you can use any tools that the master created to dismantle the master's house. And transformative politics would, in theory, be one of those arenas. I also think it identifies an area of interest convergence where between the race and sovereignty debate, where certainly those who are seeking racial equality in engaging in the act of transformative politics can create an environment that will lend itself to recognizing sovereignty and actually allowing sovereignty to reap some real benefits. But I wanted to trouble, to borrow the verb of the day, to trouble the notion of sovereignty and ask the panelists to think about whether there's a way to re-envision sovereignty in the way that we're talking about utilizing politics in a transformative way. I'm concerned about the wholesale adaptation of sovereignty, and I'm thinking, is there a way to use sovereignty for its obvious benefit, which is, inter-sovereign power broking, and not internalize that sovereignty within the groups that have already been historically subordinated? So is there a way to transform sovereignty within those groups and still utilize it vis-a-vis other sovereigns that are engaged in historical oppression?
Who's ready to tackle that one?
It's a good question.
I'm trying not to talk.
The fearless among you, please.
I mean, part of it is for me, right? When like the word sovereignty, right, is like a cipher, right? And so you got to say, you know, what is when you say the word sovereign, what do you mean, right? And you know, if you say that the people are sovereign, right, then the class of institutions that the people create, right, is the way in which you meld the powers of various sovereigns together, right? So the reason I gave you the taxonomy I gave you, right, was to suggest that the states are subject to the superior sovereignty of the people as a whole, right? But that tribes are orthogonal to that arrangement, right? Except in their relationship to states, right? So that tribes can use their capacity to make their own rules, right? Under, you know, supported by the foundation of national rights, right, to shield themselves from the depredations of the local, right? And so that's one way. Now, I say shield themselves from the depredation, but it also can mean to work in conjunction with or to cooperate, right? So I really would like to fill in the idea of sovereignty rather than just using sovereignty as just a placeholder. Every time you say it, to say, ask, what does it mean, right?
Let me address that from kind of the perspective I was asked to talk about at the panel, which is Puerto Rico and its colonial status, and kind of generalize out some of the things that I see. Puerto Rico's got and has since, well, it's been, one book on it's called The Longest Colony in the History of the World, over 500 years of being a colony. Okay, first 400 years under Spain, 100 years plus under the United States. So what do you do with that? If you're, you know, starting out with the Puerto Rican community, for instance, there is a component of the population that favors statehood. Question, do you think in this political climate that statehood, if approved, would ever be granted? But that would be one way of trying to achieve some degree of political equality, putting aside all the other transformative issues that I know that you're asking about, too. The second option is to maintain the same thing or try to negotiate some improvement on that. And the third is independence, which because of the way politics has developed with regards to the island and treatment of people there is really very unpopular with the vast majority of people. And I think you could come back and you see what I see right now going on is a big discussion. I mean, if when I was in law school, somebody had told me that we were going to be debating 14th Amendment citizenship, okay, as a legitimate question, I would have just, you know, I think everybody in the table would have laughed, okay? But that's what's being discussed in the public arena right now. And I think what that's a symptom of is that I do think we're in an era where the notion of a social compact, okay, and I don't mean it in terms of that people in Puerto Rico talk about it, a compact between Puerto Rico and the United States. I'm talking about a real compact. The notion that we have a constitution, and that's what binds, bound the different states together, imperfect as it was and has been and continues to be. I think that there's as much as ever in my lifetime a dialogue for what is really the social compact. I'll tell you that a lot of the voices I hear discussing what that social compact ought to be are ones that I have a great deal of trouble with because I feel like we're fighting the same fights that we fought, you know, in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and everything else. But, you know, coming from Texas. Anyway, and I see that in the context of the immigration situation in particular. So in terms of, you know, how you get to that transformation, at the end of the day, whether it's there, any society is going to have a set of rules and a set of organizational principles. And the question is, who gets to be at the table to discuss that, and how do we make a better society?
Yeah, just give me just a short comment or answer, attempt to answer. It's a great question. It's really in some ways the question. And so I want to let me just try to think out loud about it. I want to start with where Gerald started, that sovereignty is very much a cipher, and a lot of what has happened has been to have it be, in some sense, an infinitely flexible, sometimes invidiously so, tool, and that's the part that half of your question, right, is to how to think about that. But then, to me, what's interesting and very deep about your question is how to think about the relationship between the two versions of sovereignty that you articulated. One is sort of the internal use of sovereignty, and then the other part you described as the use of sovereignty as a way to conceptualize relationship among sovereigns. Now, to me, the only way to get out of the problem, or the many problems historically and currently with the first version of sovereignty, in other words, the version that's a cipher and that becomes a tool for subordinating people, is to give that poor version of sovereignty the content that comes from thinking of sovereignty in your second version, which is as a way of thinking about mutual respect as between sovereigns. And it's really only if those two visions of sovereignty in some sense come together that there is hope for the first version, it seems to me. So I don't think of it as a question of how can you keep one without, how can you get rid of one and keep the other? I think if keep the one you keep as has to give content to the other one, because you'll always have it, as long as we are in this current state of human social organization.
And I'll just add that I think part of the project of international human rights law, which now of course includes the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, is to navigate precisely the difficulty you're posing, whether it's in the bilateral human rights arenas, such as the one that Winona Single suggested in her concurrent panel among Native Nations, or in the international arena. We've unfortunately got to conclude this wonderful panel, because I think I could hear what they have to say much longer, but thank you very much.
Thanks to the panelists, and thank you, Carol, for moderating. We're on a 15-minute break, and then we're coming back for a closing roundtable that will be moderated by Cheryl Harris, involving Patrick, Anthony, and Kiolani. So please go out, get your last snack, burst of sugar, and come back in to close this out.